Chemical kinetics is the study of how rapidly chemical reactions occur. When we speak about kinetics, we usually discuss it in terms of change in concentration of either reactants or products over some change in time. We call this number the rate, and that is usually represented by change in concentration over change in time. In the case of a reactant, the reactant will actually be disappearing, and so we can say that the rate of the reaction is going to be negative for the change in reactant concentration, and it's going to be positive for the product concentration. Graphically, we're going to be looking at a negative change in reactant concentration. So on a graph, that line is going to decrease in slope like this because the concentration of the reactant is actually getting less over time. But for the products, the concentration is increasing over time, and so it has a positive slope. Eventually, both of these rates will sort of slow down and stop increasing or decreasing. And that's called equilibrium, and that's going to be the topic of the next couple chapters. In the study of kinetics, what we're going to be most concerned with is this initial period of either increasing or decreasing concentration, and that's called the initial rate. Reaction rates can be expressed relative to each other for a given reaction. For the decomposition of N2O5, we can tell by looking at the mole ratios in front of each of the species what the relative rate of the disappearance or appearance of those compounds will be. Because there's a 2 in front of the N2O5 and a 4 in front of the NO2, we know that for every 4 NO2s that are produced, 2 N2O5s must be used up. Likewise, for every oxygen molecule, O2, that is produced, 2 N2O5s also must be used up. Now, the reaction rates themselves have to be experimentally determined. We can't tell that just by looking at this equation. But what we can say is that the reaction rate relative to N2O5 is going to look something like this. As N2O5 is used up, that means that it's going to have a negative slope. So we'll draw a line like this. Because NO2 is a product, the slope for it will be positive. And the value relative to N2O5 goes like this. Since the number here is a 2 for the N2O5, and the number in front of NO2 is a 4, that tells us that NO2 will be produced twice as fast as N2O5 is used up. And so because of that, the slope will be twice that of the N2O5. And if we look at the oxygen, we know that the oxygen is going to be produced half as fast as the N2O5 is used up. And so the slope for oxygen is also going to be positive because it is being produced, but it's going to be much less. So oxygen is going to have a slope that's not as steep as that of NO2. So to write this down in words, what we can say is that NO2 will be produced 4/2 or 2 times faster than N2O5 is used up. Also, we can say that O2 will be produced 1/2 times as fast as N2O5 is being used up. Finally, we can say that NO2 will be produced 4 times as fast as O2 is produced. Again, we can't determine the actual rate until we do some experimentation, but if we know the rate of disappearance of N2O5, or the rate of appearance of NO2, or the rate of appearance of O2, we can use these numbers to calculate what the disappearance or appearance of any of the other species would be. As far as the units of the rate, if we consider the speed of a car, the rate of a car traveling on the road, we would measure that in miles per hour, or the distance traveled by the car per unit time. For the speed of a chemical reaction, we're going to measure that in concentration change per unit time. The unit of concentration is molarity. The unit most often used for time change is the second. And so the speed of a reaction, the rate of the reaction, is going to be given typically in molar per second. So this is usually written as molar per second, or in some cases, molar times seconds to the minus one. So if we do have a measured rate, so in this case we have the rate of O2 formation experimentally measured to be 9 times 10 to the minus 6 molar per second, we can use this number to calculate the rate of formation of NO2. So to do that, what we would do is we would set it up so that we can multiply the 9 times 10 to the minus 6 molar per second, which is the rate of O2 formation, times 4 moles of NO2 divided by 1 mole of O2, and that's going to give us 3.6 times 10 to the minus 5 molar per second of NO2 formation. Similarly, we can calculate the rate of N2O5 disappearance, and for that what we'll do is we'll take our rate of O2 formation, multiply by 2 moles N2O5 over 1 mole of O2, and the answer we get is 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5 molar per second of N2O5. Now these experimental data are given to us in the problem, so we are accepting the fact that the 9 times 10 to the minus 6 molar per second is the rate of O2 formation. In subsequent videos, we're going to look at how to go from experimental data to deriving this number right here. Generally speaking, as the temperature of the reaction increases, so does the rate. As we'll see in this chapter, the rate depends on several things, including the identity of the reactants, the concentration of the reactants, and also the temperature of the reaction. So, what's up next in the study of kinetics? First, it's going to be method of initial rates, followed by rate laws, also integrated rate laws. Next is half-life of a reaction. Next is collision theory, followed by reaction mechanisms, and finally catalysis.